So today's topic of discussion is structure of a chromosome and cell cycle, cellular reproduction, mitosis. So these topics we will discuss in this video and in further videos. So before we start with the topic, I want to give you a quick revision of the cell, the structure of the cell. So this is the structure of an animal cell, and in the center you can see this is nucleus. So nucleus is consist of nuclear envelope, double membrane enclosing the nucleus, perforated by pores and continues with endoplasmic reticulum. Then nucleolus is also present. Here this dark condensed body is nucleolus. So non-membranous structure involved in production of ribosomes. So ribosomes are produced in nucleolus. A nucleus has one or more nucleoli, depending upon the function of the cell. So if cell is indulged in protein production, then obviously there will be more ribosome needed and more nucleolus will be present in the nucleus. Then chromatin material. So chromatin material consists of DNA and histone protein visible in a dividing cell as individual condensed chromosomes. So the chromatin chromosomes are only be seen in a dividing cell or resting cell. In a resting cell, chromosomes are in the form of a tangled network, chromatin fibers. So there you cannot identify the structure of chromosome. Then the outermost layer of a cell, animal cell, is plasma membrane, and its function is to allow the cell transportation in and out substance. So as you have already read in the previous chapter about the semipermeability of plasma membrane and many things you have learned about plasma membrane. So this is the outermost layer in the animal cell. And in a plant cell, it is inner to the cell wall. Then ribosomes. Ribosomes are small dots, complexes that makes protein free in cytosol or bound to rough endoplasmic reticulum or nuclear envelope. Then this is Golgi apparatus. So organelle that is active in synthesis, modification, sorting and secretion of cell products. Then these are some other cell organelle. If you want to go in detail with the structure of the cell, then you can go through my video on cell biology. So this slide is just for a small recap. The main thing which I need to discuss today is the structure of this nucleus. So this is the structure of a nucleus. As you can see, it is bound by a nuclear envelope or nuclear membrane. It is a two-layer membrane and it contains many small pores over its surface, as you can see here. These are known as nuclear pores. So this is a magnified view of nuclear pores. So this is a pore complex. Many ribosomes are attached at the surface of nuclear membrane. Nuclear membrane is continued with the endoplasmic reticulum, majorly with the rough endoplasmic reticulum. Why this endoplasmic reticulum is known as rough endoplasmic reticulum? Since it has a ribosome over its surface. So as you can see, its appearance is very rough. That's why it is known as rough endoplasmic reticulum. Inside a nucleus, there is a darkly stained body that is nucleolus. Yes, so I was explaining about this nucleolus. So nucleolus is darkly stained body inside the nucleus. As we have already read in the previous slide, that a nucleus can have one or more nucleolus depending upon the function of the cell. This nucleolus basically involved in the protein synthesis as it synthesizes the ribosomes. Then there is a network, tangled network of colored bodies are present. So this network of colored bodies is known as chromatin fibers. Okay, so this is the closer look of a chromatin fiber. This blue color thread, it is actually the DNA, and this purple color molecules, these are actually the histone. So DNA encircle the histone proteins, and then it coiled and supercoiled and ultimately forms a chromatin fiber. So chromatin fiber is basically made up of DNA and histone protein. So is this slide clear to everyone? Okay. So next is, what is chromosome? So first of all, chromosome was discovered by Walther Fleming when he was studying the cell division in the cell of salamander, and he saw densely colored bodies in the nucleus of the cell. Then because these bodies are rich in color, they get high staining. That's why he give these bodies the name chromosome. Chromo is the color, zome is the body. So the word chromosome means colored body. Then in the interphase of the cell, what is interphase? The resting phase of the cell, when the cell is not dividing. So in the interphase of the cell, the chromosomes are decondensed, and they are in the form of a tangled network that we cannot identify their shapes. But when the cell prepare for the division, and when the cell is in its metaphase of the cell division, then these chromosomes clearly take this shape. So this is a metaphasic chromosome, and this is a pre-replication chromosome. So what is a pre-replication chromosome? What is a metaphase chromosome? You will be better understand when we will discuss about the cell division. So right now you just understand that this is the chromosome when the cell is just preparing for the division. So for dividing, the cell need to duplicate the chromosome. So when it duplicate itself, it look like this. So this is a metaphasic chromosome. So in the metaphase of the cell, chromosome clearly look like this. So the best stage to study the structure of a chromosome is metaphase of a cell. So this is the structure of a metaphasic chromosome. As you can see here, it is made up of two chromatids, and since these chromatids are clone of each other, both of them possess same DNA. So that's why they are known as sister chromatids. These sister chromatids are attached to each other on the point centrosome. Okay, and this centrosome also provide a surface for the attachment of spindle fibers during the cell division. So this chromatin is constituted 40% DNA and 60% of histone. So is this slide clear, everyone? So the next topic is classification of chromosome on the basis of the position of centromere. So these are the four type of chromosome: telocentric, acrocentric, submetacentric, and metacentric. These all four type of chromosome are on the basis of the position of their centromere. So when the centromere at the apex, so two sister chromatids are joined at their head with the help of centromere, these kind of chromosomes are known as telocentric chromosome. Then what is acrocentric chromosome? When this centromere is little below the apex. So it is not in the center, it is not at the apex, rather it is just below the apex. So these kind of chromosome are known as acrocentric chromosome. When the centromere is in exact middle, when it is in the exact middle position, then this kind of chromosomes are known as metacentric. Then what is submetacentric? Submetacentric, when this centromere is not in exact middle, rather it is little above than the middle, then this is known as submetacentric chromosome. In a telocentric chromosome, only one chromosome arm is there, as you can see. Rather, in all these three, two arms are there depending on the position of the centromere. So if the centromere is in center, both P arm and Q arm, they have the same length. If the centromere is above the center, then P arm is little shorter than the Q arm. And if the centromere is little below the apex, then P arm is very much shorter than the Q arm. Then what is this satellite? Satellite body is the extra amount of chromosome which is present attached with the P arm. So is it clear, everyone? So next is DNA double helical model of Watson-Crick. So DNA, it was first, this DNA was first studied by X-ray diffraction of data by Rosalind Franklin and Maurice Wilkins at King's College London. And on the basis of their finding, Watson and Crick proposed this particular structure of DNA in the same year. Okay, so this structure, this is actually the structure of a B-DNA. Okay, B-DNA. So DNA is also present in many other forms, A-DNA, B-DNA, C-DNA, D-DNA, Z-DNA, many other forms of DNA are there. But this particular structure was given by Watson and Crick. This was a form of B-DNA. Okay, so this is also known as a double helical model. Why it is known as a double helical model? Since it, first of all, it is made up of two strands. So as you can see, two strands are interwoven with each other. Okay, that's why it is a double strand model. Then what is helical? Since they are woven in the form of a helix, so it is, suppose this is an imaginary center axis and this entire DNA is wrapped around this center axis in the form of a helix. That's why this particular model of DNA is known as a double helical model. So there are certain important points regarding this double helical model. So this molecule is composed of two chains of nucleotides, first of all. So these are the two, this is one chain and this is the other chain. So this is composed of two chains of nucleotide. The two chains spiral around each other to form a pair of right-handed helix. So this particular B-DNA, it is spiral in a right-handed pattern. So the two chains of a spiral around each other to form a pair of right-handed helix. So this is particularly a right-handed helix. Z-DNA is a left-handed helix. So this is not universal ki every DNA will be a right-handed helix. Left-handed helix are also there in some forms of DNA. Then the two chains comprises one double helix run in opposite direction, that is they are anti-parallel. So these both chains are anti-parallel. As you can see here, one chain is from 3 prime to 5 prime and the other chain is from 5 prime to 3 prime. So both of them are parallel to each other but in the opposite direction. That's why they are known as anti-parallel. What is 3 prime, what is 5 prime? This is little higher thing. You won't understand. So for now, you just understand this thing. Ki these chains are parallel to each other but they are opposite also in the direction. So these chains are known as anti-parallel chains. The sugar phosphate backbone of each strand is located on the outside of the molecule. So as you can see, the strands are basically, this backbone is basically made up of sugar phosphate molecules. So one sugar, then one phosphate. Which sugar is this? This is the deoxyribose sugar. And then one phosphate group. Then once again the deoxyribose sugar, then one phosphate group. So this backbone is made up of sugar and phosphate backbone. So the two strands are held together by hydrogen bond between each base of one strand and associated base on the other strand. So both of them are together bound by these hydrogen bonds. You can see these dots, they are representing the hydrogen bonding between these bases. T, A, G, C, what these are? These are the nitrogen bases. So basically DNA is made up of four type of nitrogen bases: adenine, guanine, cytosine and thymine. So they are divided into two categories, pyrimidines and purines. What is pyrimidine? What is purine? They are basically according to the cyclic structure of carbon. So this is something different. So I will show you the structure of cytosine, thymine, adenine and guanine. Then you will understand what is a purine, what is a pyrimidine. For now, you understand two nitrogen bases, that is cytosine and thymine, they are the pyrimidine bases, and other two, adenine and guanine, they are the purine bases. So these bases, they are held together by hydrogen bonds with each other, and as a result, both the strands of DNA, they are interlinked together. So these nitrogen bonds, they have a fixed pattern of joining. This adenine is always joined with this thymine with two hydrogen bonds, and this guanine is always bounded with cytosine by three hydrogen bonds. This is fixed. Adenine can join with thymine only, and guanine can join with cytosine only, because their structure don't allow them to bind with some other nitrogen base. So it will never happen ki adenine will bound with cytosine or guanine will bound with thymine. Okay, so always adenine and thymine are bound together by a double hydrogen bond, and guanine and cytosine, they are bound together by triple hydrogen bond. Okay, so everything clear in this slide?